الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today's reflection is going to be on حسن الخاتمة having a good end and dying in a good way. The first point regarding this is the righteous people, how humble and how humiliated they were, and humble in their actions, they would never be deceived by their ability. And they never saw themselves to be something. They were very humble, tawadu. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah, he mentions in the biography of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, الإمام أحمد بن حنبل رحمه الله. He says عن عباس الدوري. He said حدثني علي بن أبي فزارة وكان جارا لنا. He was a neighbor of ours. And this is a story that happened to Imam Ahmed. So listen to the humility and humbleness of Imam Ahmed. الإمام أحمد, a man came to him. His name is Ali ibn Abi Fazara. He came to Ahmed rahimahullah, and Ali ibn Abi Fazara, he had a mother. He said, كانت أمي مقعدة منذ 20 سنة. My mother for 20 years, she was disabled. She couldn't move. She was in place, one place. فقالت لي يوما, my mother said to me one day, يا بني, my son, اذهب إلى إمام أحمد, go to Imam Ahmed rahimahullah. And ask him, فَاسْأَلْهُ أَنْ يَدْعُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ لِي. Ask Imam Ahmed to supplicate for me so Allah can remove this illness from me. عَسَى اللَّهُ, it is possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أَنْ يَتَقَبَّلَ دُعَاهُ. Allah might accept Imam Ahmed's dua. Because of course Ahmed was an imam and he was a man who was righteous, a noble individual. فَيُبَرِّئَنِي مِنَ الْمَرَضِ الَّذِي أَلَمَّ بِي. And the dua Ahmed makes for me is going to take this illness away from me. فَذَهَبْتُ, I went. On behalf of his mother, so he said, I came to Ahmed. فَضَرَبْتُ الْبَابَ, I knocked on the door. فَإِذَا هُوَ, Imam Ahmed was in his house, يُصَلِّي, praying. He's in the middle of a prayer. فَلَمَّا فَرَغَ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ, when Ahmed رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ finished the prayer, he said, مَنْ, who? Who is this person who's knocking on the door? And then he said, I said to him, Fulan, it's so-and-so. وَقَدْ أَرْسَلَتْنِي أُمِّي, my mother has sent me. And my mother, for 20 years, she's been in one place. She's ill, she can't move. And Imam Ahmed said, what do you want from me? He said, my mother is asking that you supplicate for her, that Allah might remove this illness from her. فَأَجَابَنِي مُغْضِبًا. And Imam Ahmed, أما مغضباً, and Imam Ahmed responded مغضباً, angry, excessively angry. وقال, he then said, بل أنا أحوج إلى دعائها, I am in more need of her dua than she in being in need of my dua. I need her dua more than she needs my dua. And then he said, I left Ahmed, فانصرفت, I walked away from Imam Ahmed's house, and as I was walking, an old woman came out of Imam Ahmed's house. And she said to me, قَدْ تَرَكْتُهُ يَدْعُ اللَّهَ لَهَا. Don't worry, I left Ahmed and he was making dua for your mom. She said to him, don't worry, Ahmed didn't forget to make dua for your mother. I mean, he's making dua for her. But let's ponder on the statement that Ahmed said, rahimahullah, what did he say? بَلْ أَنَا أَحْوَجُ, I am in more need, أَنْ تَدْعُ اللَّهَ, that supplication and dua is made for, مِنْ أَنْ أَدْعُوَ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَهَا, I am in more need of her dua than she needs my dua. And this would come from a man who doesn't see himself to be something high. who has the humility in knowing that this nafs is weak and it requires Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's aid and support. My beloved brothers and sisters, we need to be scared of su'ul khatimah. We need to be scared of our evil ending. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran a story. And He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ O Muhammad, read on them. نَبَأَ الَّذِي The story of the one. آتَيْنَاهُ We gave him آيَاتِنَا Our verses. فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا He exited. He left it. We gave him our verses and he walked away from it and he left it. فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ Then shaytan followed his path. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ And he became from those who were destroyed. وَلَوْ شِئْنَا Allah says, if we willed and we wanted, لَرَفَعْنَاهُ We would have raised him. Stations and ranks. وَلَكِنَّهُ But he, this individual, أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ He chose to go down. Allah wanted to raise him. But he wanted to go down. He wanted this earth. Allah wanted the hereafter for him. Allah wanted to give him a higher station. وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ And he followed his whims and his desires. فَمَثَلُهُ His parable, his example is كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ The likes of an example of a dog. إِن تَحْمِلَ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثُ If you give to the dog and you provide for the dog, his tongue will still be out. And if you do not give the dog, أو تَتْرُكُ يَلْهَثُ The dog is still the same. It doesn't change. Meaning this man, when the Quran was given to him, it didn't change him. It didn't make him a better person. This man, his story is su'ul khatima, a very bad ending. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave him the Quran, but he chose to turn away from it. So his final ending, was it good? His final ending is like that of a dog, the lowest ranked animal. That's what his example is. You sometimes find brothers who memorize the Quran, they've learned the book of Allah, and they chose to turn away from the book. The Quran that they've memorized, the wordings that they've got, they turn away from it. He's hanging around with people who don't know anything about the religion. Chris is his friend and Michael and Steve. But he has a different identity. He's got the Quran. Allah gave him the Quran. So he chose to turn away from it. That person, أخلد إلى الأرض, he has chosen something low from something great that was given to him. وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ He follows his whims and his desires. So that person should be very worried of a bad ending. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companions were not like that, like him. The Quran, they stuck by its wording and they also stuck by its what? Meaning, and they pondered over it. وَلِذَلِكَ الإمام الطرطوشي in his كتاب الحوادث والبدع he says لم يكن في أصحاب رسول الله it was not present in the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم من يقرأ القرآن a person who would read the Quran ولا يتدبره and will not ponder over it it was not amongst the companions a person who would read the Quran but will not ponder over it ويفقه معانيه and it was not amongst them a person who would not understand its meaning they would all work towards understanding what Allah is saying to them because the Quran was sent down for that purpose أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقَفَالُهَا أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ The Quran was sent down for that pondering, right? So the Sahabas made sure that they pondered on it. وَإِنَّمَا حَدَثَتْ هَذِهِ الْبِدْعَةِ This innovation, what innovation is he talking about? Reading the Quran but not pondering on it, not understanding what it means. This innovation of just learning the wordings, learning the makharij, just learning how to pronounce it properly. This innovation, it occurred and it happened بعد ذلك في أقوام in a group of people. This innovation started later. This is not what the companions did. So are they different to the one whose example وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا وَلَكِنَّهُ أَقْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ. Is this and the companions, are they the same? Huh? The difference is that these individuals, the Quran is what governed their lives. So they lived by it. So that story showed us su'ul khatimah, the bad ending a person can have. Ibn Abi Mulaika, who was a tabi'i, he said, as Imam al-Bukhari narrated it mu'allaqan. And a hadith in Bukhari, which is mu'allaq, means that Bukhari doesn't mention the teacher who he narrated from. بِسِغَةِ الْجَزْمِ, but he mentions it in a form of authenticating it. That Ibn Abi Mulaika said, أَدْرَكْتُ, I met 30 من أصحاب رسول الله. I met 30 of the companions of the Prophet. كلهم, all of them. يخاف على نفسه من النفاق. All of those which I met, they all feared hypocrisy. They were all scared that they might die an evil death. They were all scared of hypocrisy. أصحاب رسول الله, the companions of the Prophet. They were scared of what? يخشون النفاق. They feared hypocrisy. And they were also scared of what? سوء الخاتمة. Amongst them were who, brothers and sisters? Amongst them is companions who were promised paradise. Whilst they were walking on this earth, the only thing that they were waiting for is to taste the bitterness of death, and then Jannah awaits them on the other side. That's it. What's between them and Jannah is what? Jannah, death. And they were still scared of what? They were still scared of hypocrisy. So a person who doesn't know where they're going to be, and you don't know where you're going to go to, you should be the person who is the most scaredest. There are people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave them iman, but then their final ending became hypocrisy. And they became munafiqeen after having received iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us examples in the Quran, but let's just take one example. This example is what Allah mentions in Surah At-Tawbah. Allah says, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ, if you ask them, لَيَقُولُنَّ, they will say to you, O Muhammad, إِنَّمَا, we were nothing except. The word إِنَّمَا is مِنْ أَدَوَاتِ الْحَصْرِ. And الْحَصْرِ means الْإِثْبَاتُ لِلْمَذْكُورِ وَنَفْلُ عَمَّا عَدَى. It means there was no other thing we were doing this for. إِنَّمَا كُنَّا, our only intent in this was نَخُوضُ وَنَلْعَبُ. We were just trying to spend time like this and we were only joking. We were only having fun. قُلْ, say to them, Muhammad, أَبِاللَّهِ, in Allah, وَآيَاتِ, and the verses of Allah, وَرَسُولِهِ, and His Messenger, كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ, are you mocking? لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا, don't look for excuses. قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ, verily you have become disbelievers. بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ, after you gained and you received iman. إِنْ نَعْفُ, if we forgive, عَنْ طَائِفَةٍ, if we forgive a group, مِنْكُمْ, from amongst you, نُعَذِّبْ, we will verily punish, طَائِفَةً, a group of people from amongst you. And the reason why is because بِأَنَّهُمْ, they were كَانُوا مُجْرِمِينَ, they were criminals and wrongdoers. This verse has a sabab nuzul, a story to it. As Ibn Jarir al-Tabari mentions in his tafsir bi sanadin hasan, that Abdullah ibn Umar, he said this was one of the battles of the Prophet, and this was Ghazwat al-Tabuk. A group of individuals, they sat with one another, and when they sat down, some of them said, لَمْ أَرَى كَقُرَّائِنَا, we have never seen anyone like our reciters. أَرْغَبَ بُطُونًا, what do they mean, أَرْغَبَ بُطُونًا, أي أَوْسَعَ بُطُونًا, those who eat more than them. Our reciters, they love munching. They love eating. وَلَا أَجْمَنَ عِنْدَ اللِّقَى. And when they meet the enemies, they are the most coward of all. وَلَا أَكْذَبَ أَلْسُنَنَ. And there is no one more of a great liar than them. And they're referring to here who? Nabiullah Muhammad. And they're referring to who? حَمَلَةُ الْقُرْآنِ. The people who are carrying the Quran, who were the companions of the Prophet. Today, if you go on Twitter, you look at Instagram, you look at Facebook, you find a lot of Muslims mocking the religion. And they're laughing. You should be scared of these verses. Dangerous, right? The symbols of Islam, they're mocking. They're laughing. And another person tweets it, and another one tweets it, and he's tweeting it, and they're laughing about it. They should be scared and worried and concerned in falling into this. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ A man from amongst them who was sitting with them said to them, أَنْتُمْ He said, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنَافِقٌ Ahmad said, بَلْ أَنْتَ مُنَافِقٌ Rather you, who said this, is a hypocrite. تَتَكَلَّمُ بِالنِّفَاقِ You speak with hypocrisy. وَلَا أَحْمِلَنَّهَا I will carry this incident to who? إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ I will tell the Prophet about what you guys did. فَذَهَبَ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ The man came to the Prophet. But before he could even inform the Prophet of the incident that happened, revelation already came to the Prophet. From high above, Allah already told him what happened. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these verses, they came down. So these men, after having tasted the sweetness of al-Iman, what did they lose? The Iman was taken away from them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgave. But He said, لَا تَعْتَدِلُوا قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ إِنْ نَعْفُ عَنْ طَائِفَةٍ The one who is being given, forgiven here is مَخْشِي بْنُ حُمَيْرٍ رضي الله تعالى عنه إِنْ نَعْفُ If we forgive, is referring to him. That was a companion who was forgiven. Because he begged the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and it was accepted from him. But the rest they weren't. So this ayah, it shows us how somebody can gain iman and it can leave him. Our Prophet used to ask Allah, al-thabatu ala deen. He used to consistently ask Allah to keep him firm upon the religion. The Prophet used to say, Allahumma, O Allah, ya muqallib al-qulub, the one who turns and tosses the heart. Thabbit qulubana. Make our hearts firm upon ala deenika, your religion. Make our hearts firm upon your religion. Anas ibn Malik, a companion, he said, a man said to the Prophet, when the Prophet said that, a man said to the Prophet, Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, Inna qad amanna bika, we believed in you. Wa saddaqna, we also have trusted and also believed. بِمَا جِئْتَ بِهِ That which you have come with مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالنُّورِ The guidance that you have brought us. The light that you have come with, we have believed in it. And we've taken it on board. أَفَتَخْشَ عَلَيْنَا Do you fear for us? Are you scared? Are you worried for us? The messenger said, إِنَّمَا قُلُوبُ الْخَلْقِ The people's hearts, جَمِيعًا all of them are بَيْنَ أُصْبُعَيْنِ مِنْ أَصَابِعِ الرَّحْمَانِ It is between the two fingers of Allah. يُقَلِّبُهَا Allah turns it. كَيْفَ يَشَاءَ However He wills. In other words, yes, your hearts are between the two fingers of Allah. Allah tosses and He turns it the way He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah, they narrated it, and Shaykh Nasir, rahimahullah, he authenticated it in his kitab al-Mishkat al-Masabih. So our Prophet, the best man who walked on this earth, is supplicating to Allah and he's asking Allah, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub, the one who tosses and turns the hearts, ثَبِّتْ قَلْبِي عَلَى دِينِكَ Keep my heart steadfast upon your religion. Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah, a man came to him and he said to him, هَلْ بَكَيْتَ عَلَى سَابِقِ عِلْمِ اللَّهِ فِيكَ Have you ever cried A man came to Sufyan al-Thawri and he said to him, have you cried because of the knowledge that Allah has of you, while Allah knows that you're going to finally end and what has been destined for you? Doesn't it make you cry when you remember it and you think about it? And Sufyan al-Thawri used to say, taraktani la afrahu, you have left me never going to be happy again. Min ba'diha abada, I'm no longer going to be happy based on what you've told me. If you ponder and you think today, how many people do you know who were once in the front line in the masjid? They were fasting Mondays and Thursdays. They were righteous, they were upright, they were steadfast. And suddenly everything changed. And things have gone the opposite. Or as you guys would call it, it went pear-shaped. Things have changed. Malik ibn Dinar, he used to stand in front, he used to face towards the Qibla, and he would cry and he would say, Ya Rabbi, my Lord, قَدْ عَلِمْتَ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ, oh Allah, you know the people of Jannah. مِنْ أَهْلِ النَّارِ, from the people of the hellfire. Oh Allah, you know the people of Jannah from the people of the hellfire. You know. فَفِي أَيِّ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ, from which of those two groups كُتِبَ مَالِك, is Malik ibn Dinar in? He would stand and he would face the Qibla and he would say to himself, oh Allah, you know the people of Jannah from the people of the hellfire. Which of those two parties is Malik from amongst? And he would cry and he would carry on crying. And the reason why he would cry is ala sabiq ilmillah, the knowledge that Allah has of you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that which He has prepared for you. My beloved brothers and sisters, لا تغتر بالظاهر, don't ever be deceived by the apparent form that you see from a person. And وَسْأَلْ رَبَّكَ الْإِخْلَاصِ, don't be deceived by the outer appearance. And always ask Allah sincerity. Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us a story of a man. And this story is found in Bukhari and Muslim, in the two most authentic books after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the authority of the companion Sahl ibn Sa'ad al-Sa'idi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet told us, or the story, the narration mentions to us, that there was a man who went out in one of the expeditions, in one of the battles with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this man, the companions, they saw him to be the best and the most strongest and the most dedicated man from amongst them. The narration mentions, فَكَانَ لَا يَدَعُ شَادَّةً وَلَا فَادَّةً إِلَّا اتَّخَذَهَا. This man in the battle, he presented efforts. And he came with that which no one surpassed. He fought well. So the companions, when they came back to their camp, because the battle, it goes on for a while, people go to sleep and they carry on after. When they came back and they conversed amongst themselves, they started to talk, they mentioned him and everybody saw him. Everybody was speaking about him in a good light, praising him, glorifying him, venerating him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he heard them. And when he heard them, what they were saying about this man, the Prophet said to them, huwa min ahli an-nar, this man is from the people of the hellfire. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ أَيْمَانٌ, then said, أَنَا صَاحِبُهُ, I will accompany this man. I will be with him, shoulder to shoulder. I will be his shade. So when the battle went back, and they went to fight again, and they fought, he said, I made sure I watched that man. I wanted to observe him and see what he's up to. The man in the battle, he got wounded. A severe wound hit him. And when he got wounded, فَلَمْ يَصْبِرْ عَلَى أَلَمِهَا, He could not endure the pain. فَجَعَلَ نَصْلَ سَيْفِهِ He placed his sword upwards. He made the sharp side face up. And he placed his stomach on it. And he brought himself to death. He hastened his life. He hastened his death. When the man saw him killing himself, he ran back to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. فرجع الرجل إلى رسول الله. The man ran back to the Prophet. فقال, he said to the Prophet, أشهد, I testify, أنك رسول الله, that you are a messenger sent from Allah. حقا وصدقا, that you are truly a messenger sent from Allah. فقال له النبي, the Prophet then said to him, وما ذاك, why? Why have you said that? He said, when you said what you said, O Messenger of Allah, that this man is in the hellfire, I made sure that I went with him. And I made sure I observed him. And what he did was, he killed himself. He committed suicide. He killed himself. The Messenger then said a powerful statement here. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ, that one of you, لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, he would do the action of the people of Jannah, فِيمَا يَبْدُو لِلنَّاسِ, all of that is as it seems to the people. He is doing the action of the people of Jannah, فِيمَا يَبْدُو لِلنَّاسِ, as it seems to the people. It looks like this man, what he is doing and everything he holds up to, and his principles are all what? From the apparent, it looks like he's from the people of Jannah. So what's the problem here? The problem here is the efforts are only directed at the zahir. He's only working on his outer appearance. And he's only working on his beard and how short his garment is. But he's forgetting that he should what? The heart. The greatest organ that he needs to observe, he's forgetting to look at that. So everything he's doing is what it seems from the outer. ثُمَّ يَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ And then what was written from him overcomes him. فَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ And so he does the action of the people of the hellfire. فَيَدْخُلُ النَّارَ He then enters the hellfire. And another one, وَإِنْ أَحَدَكُمْ لَيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلِ أَهْلِ النَّارِ Another person, he does the action of the people of the hellfire. فِيمَا يَبْدُو لِلنَّاسِ As it seems to the people. He's drinking alcohol, he's committing zina, this and that. All of this is from the outer though. Internally, this man, his heart is strong. He's got some good khayr in him. He's going off track. He's misbehaving himself now. But he has a strong element in his heart. ثُمَّ يَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ That element that was in his heart overcomes everything. And so he starts to do the action of the people of Jannah. Suddenly the man just changes, or the girl changes. And they start working towards good. And then they die upon that path. So they enter Jannah. So don't let you ever get fooled by you having the outer appearance done, when it's really important to work on your what? Your inner self. Our Prophet said in the hadith, Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, مَا مِن نَفْسٍ مَنْفُوسَةٍ إِلَّا وَقَدْ كَتَبَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ مَقْعَدَهَا مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ There is not a person who breathes except Allah has written for them, the Lord of the heavens and the earth has written for them a place in Jannah, or maq'adaha min al-nari, or a place in the hellfire. Everybody, he has a place in Jannah and he has a place in the hellfire, everyone. وَعَلِمَ اللَّهُ Allah knows. رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ The Lord of the heavens and the earth, he knows. مِنْ أَهْلِ الشَّقَاوَةِ هِيَ أَمْ مِنْ أَهْلِ السَّعَادَةِ Allah knows, is he from the people of Jannah? Or is he from the people of the... Jazakallah khairan. Is he from the people of Jannah? Should he be taken to the place that was made for him in Jannah? or is he from the people of the hellfire? And is he going to be taken to the hellfire? وَلِذَلِكَ You guys know a surah called Surah Al-Taghabun, right? There's a surah in the Quran called Surah Al-Taghabun, right? Yeah? What juz is it in? Surah Al-Taghabun, what juz is it in? Huh? Where? What juz? But Sana, mashallah. Sah? So Surah Al-Sunnah, we expect Quran from you guys. Masjid Sunnah, where we live in West London and other places, we hear Quran here is strong. So As-Sunnah can't let us down, okay? I'm going to pick up the young kids from As-Sunnah. Good. So Surah Al-Taghabun, what does it mean? What does Taghabun mean? Yeah? Does anyone know what Taghabun means? Huh? What does Taghabun mean? Who can help us here? It's not a rhetorical question, a direct question. I need somebody to answer it. Yeah? Not me. Yes. Huh? You don't know. Hey, who else? Who can tell us what Taghabun means? Yeah. You guys can't look at Google or something? Can't Google it up? Huh?
Lost and gay.
Yeah?
Lost and gay.
Loss and Jameel. Sah. Taghabun means the person, the day of judgment when he comes and he is shown, may Allah protect us from this, he is shown his place in Jannah. And he said, this could have been your place in Jannah, but you chose to be a criminal and you chose to go against Allah's command. So you're now going to enter in this place in hellfire. What does he feel? He's lost a great, great reward he could have received. Huh? That's the names of the day of judgment. So every slave, there's a place in Jannah for him, and there's a place in the hellfire. Every one of us. If we make it to Jannah, we will be told this could have been your place in the hellfire, but you got saved. How's he going to feel? Happy. Knowing, Alhamdulillah, I made it through. Brothers and sisters, what really matters is not how good you were all your life. What really matters is إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. What really matters and what is observed is your final endings. That's what matters. If all of your life you were a Muslim, but the last minutes before you pass out, before you pass away and you die, and you become a disbeliever, will it matter the 30, 40 years you were a Muslim? Will it matter? But remember, you are most likely going to die upon that which you used to do in the course of your life. If you were a noble person who spent majority of his time in the masjid, the chances of you dying in the masjid is higher. But if you're spending your time on the streets, on the corner, yeah, you're spending your time selling and buying drugs, the chances of, and you're doing that very often, you're most likely going to die in that way. So what matters is what? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمُ. I'm going to tell you guys a story, and I'm going to conclude with that story, inshallah ta'ala. This story, Ibn Kathir mentions in his kitab, Al-Bidayah wal-Nihayah. And he transmitted this story from the great Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, his kitab Al-Muntadam fi al-Tariq wal-Umam. Ama fi Tariq al-Umam. So Ibn Kathir took it from Ibn al-Jawzi. A man whose name used to be called Abduh ibn Abd al-Rahim. His name was what? Abduh ibn Abd al-Rahim. This man, he had two noble characteristics. The first noble characteristics that he had was he was a hafid bi kitabillah. He memorized the what? The book of Allah. The second characteristic that this man had, he was kathirul ghazwi lil-Rum. He used, every time the Muslims would go and fight with the Romans, he would always be with the Muslims and he would fight with the Romans. So he was a man that the people respected. They loved him, they admired him. A righteous individual. One day, they were in a fortress. They were in a hisn, a fortress. The Muslims were protecting that fortress from the Romans. He was in the fortress and his eye caught a Roman woman. He saw a Roman woman walking. When he saw her, he approached her. And when he approached her, he went to her and he said to her, كيف السبيل إليك? How is it that I can get to you? What is it that I have to do if I want your hand in marriage? She said to him, لا سبيل, there's no way إلا بأن تترك الإسلام. There's no way to get to me unless you what? Unless you leave Islam. وتدخل في الكفر, and you enter into this disbelief. ففعل, he did. He walked away from Islam. He chose kufr and disbelief of Allah. He followed her. He left the fortress of the Muslims that he was in, and he entered into the fortress of the Romans in which he was fighting all those years. So the narrator of the story, he said, فَكُنَّا نَمُرُّ عَلَيْهِ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ. We would come across this man, we would see him, Abduh ibn Abdul Rahim. We would see him, and we would walk by him. وَنَنظُرُ إِلَيْهِ, we would look at him. وَنَقُولُ لَهُ, we would say to him, كَيْفَ شَأْنُكَ, what's your affairs? فَيَقُولُ, he would say, وَاللَّهِ, by Allah, إِنِّي الْآنَ, I write at this moment, مَا أَذْكُرُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ, I don't remember the Qur'an. إِلَّا تِلْكَ الْآيَةِ, only one verse. رُبَّمَا يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْ كَانُوا مُسْلِمِينَ. I only remember this verse. This verse, what does it mean? That the disbelievers will wish the day of judgment if only they were Muslims. رُبَّمَا يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ, that the disbelievers, they will wish if only they could be believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Muslims. That's what I remember. There's no other ayah that I remember from the Quran. He forgot everything. And the one ayah that was remaining with him is the verse that's a proof against him. Su'ul Khatima. That's a bad, evil ending. And some of you might think this is a story that took place many years ago. This is not... But I remember a young boy who was in the masjid that we were in. He was in our masjid. And he was... He started a program in our masjid memorizing the Quran. And on the internet he got to know a Polish girl. He met a Polish girl. And this brother is in the masjid. He's in a Quran, 2-year Quran program, memorizing the Quran. He's one of the elite students. He was handpicked to be part of the program. What he did was he met this girl on social media. This Polish girl said to him, you have to come to Poland. He spoke of Poland. He took a flight to Poland. For a while, no one heard from him. He brought her to London. Oh, they came together to London. And then when I last saw him, I saw him drinking alcohol. And inshallah ta'ala, he's not going to have an evil ending. Inshallah ta'ala, Allah is going to bring him back. But it's worry. In the course of your life, you will see many people that you once knew, who were upright, steadfast, wallahi, they slipped. And I'll tell you, brothers, the first step of deviation, the first step, if you really want to know that you are going to become corrupted and you're scared and you're worried that this might happen to you, I will tell you something, if you do, you might be saved. And that is, stick with the masjid. When you see that you are far from the masjid, you disconnect yourself from the masjid, you are vulnerable. Because when shaitan now comes, he has to take you from a crowd of many Muslims, and you're with your jama'ah. For him to come and attack you is not easy for him. Sah? If you're with your boys, and your rivalries, they come and you're with your boys on the block, can they get to you? Yeah? But what about if you leave your area code and you go to another one? Hey, what's happening? What's going to happen? Huh? You go, what happens? You know what's going to happen. You know what day of the week is. Huh? That's the reality. If you leave the masjid, that's where you're from. This is your identity. This is where it is. The day that you take a step out, you've left your area code. Now shaitan, for him, is, as the Prophet said, إِنَّ الذِّئْبَ يَأْكُلُ الْغَنَمُ الْقَاسِي. The wolf eats the goat that's alone. Have you guys watched wildlife? I've watched the wildlife. What does it do? When the herd of sheep are together, what does it try to do? It tries to get one out of the herd. You try to get one out of the group. True or false? Once it turns towards the opposite, that's it. The lion is on to that one. But whilst they are all together, is he able to get them? That's what it is. So if you really want to know why many people fall off, is the first step is that they stop coming to the masjid. They stop coming to the masjid. And once they do stop coming to the masjid, hadith wala haraj. It's a chain of problems, it's a domino effect. Everything now is open. You do drugs, then zina, and then khamar, and then murder, and whatnot, and you're open to going to prison. And I say that to everybody. I'm Abdurrahman Hassan, I'm an imam of a masjid. The first reason why I'm the imam of that masjid is for myself. I'm doing it for myself. And if I take a step out of that, the masjid, and I walk out of it, I'm scared for myself. I am scared for myself that I might get attacked by shaitan. But whilst I'm with my brothers and I'm in the masjid and in between those walls, I'm safe, inshallah ta'ala. So remember that. Remember that statement I said to you. And think about it. How many brothers do you know who are coming to the masjid and are selling drugs? It's either no, none or never, sah? They don't. So inshallah ta'ala, that was the reflection of today. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me as shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.